Our reading from Acts. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came to them, much annoyed, because they were teaching the people and proclaiming that in Jesus there is the resurrection of the dead. So they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who heard the word believed, and they numbered about 5,000. The next day their rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power, or by what name, do you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you, to all the people of Israel, that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you on this day from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Well, today is the festival of the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, three persons, a mystery. Today's the day where pastors are tempted to get out the flow charts. Start to talk about how the Father relates to the Son, and how the Son relates to the Father, and how the Spirit relates to the Father and Son, and that's kind of exhausting, isn't it? Today is a day where we test our math skills, because we'll say 1 plus 1 plus 1 isn't 3, but 1 plus 1 plus 1 somehow remains 1. Today is a day where we stretch our use of metaphors a little bit, you know, like an object can be a gas or a liquid or a solid. I don't know if that quite works. Some people will use the apple, you know, you've got the skin and then the fruity part and the core. I don't know if that works really that well either. St. Patrick used the clover, you know, it's one leaf but it's got three petals. That's an image. It's an image. In recent years, I've thought about people, like the heroes of the faith, the saints that really are not only articulated the Trinity, but somehow lives were transformed as a result. A few years ago, I thought about Athanasius, which I just love his name, who stood up among them and who proclaimed that, you know, Jesus was Son of God and a human being, divine and human, and defended that so much that a whole creed is named after him later on. Or think of teachers like Augustine, or people like St. Patrick, or just those people of the faith that you know in your own life who seem to know that it's all about God's relationship and how we enter into it. There's that great image that the Eastern Church uses of the dance, where Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are joined in a circle with almost arms around one another, and there's another spot there for you to join in. We'll sing a song about that as our hymn of the day. But today I want to think about something else. I want to think about where it's going. I want to think about the way that God calls us forward. A Trinitarian trajectory. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit calling us out into the world and what that might look like. We're engaging the book of Acts this summer. And you've already done some pre-work and you didn't even know that. So a couple of weeks ago, we heard the story of the Ascension. Luke tells two stories of the Ascension, one at the end of his Gospel and one at the beginning of the book of Acts. In the end of Luke, when the disciples go up to the mountain and Jesus goes to his Father, the disciples, they go to the temple where they are continually praising God. Acts. He's got a whole book to talk a little bit more in detail after this happens and Jesus goes to be with the Father. The disciples are standing around. And angels who happen to be standing among them say, "Well, why are you still looking up? I haven't quite made it to the temple yet." Last week, we heard the story of what they were doing. In the meantime, they were afraid still. They were hiding. They were back in the upper room where they started, the same upper room where Jesus broke bread with them, the same upper room where they retreated after he was crucified and buried, the same upper room where the women came back to them and told them that he is raised, but they dismissed it as an idle tale. The same place where a couple of them went to go check it out for themselves, but here they were, still hanging out in that place. Some 50 days later, when the Spirit came, just as Jesus said it would, blowing through them like a mighty wind, casting on them fire, and they went out into the market and they started telling people about what God had done. It's a trajectory. God calls us somewhere. Now, the chapter that we didn't read, chapter 3, Peter and John go out and they're preaching. They are actually on the way to the temple. And they see this poor fellow who's sitting at the gate. He's a beggar. He can't walk. And they say to him, "In the name of Jesus Christ, get up." And he does. They're on their way to the temple, but now they've done something different. It seemed like a nice story so far. It's about their fear. It's about their faithfulness. It's about listening to that call. It's about that thrust of that wind that pushes us forward. But now they've done something drastic because they've entered the religious institution. And you know, when you start introducing change in the religious institution, you're going to get a little pushback. But what is the trajectory of God to stir up some trouble, to call us forward, and to never leave us quite the same afterwards? So now Peter and John have upset the religious authorities. They're all there. You've heard all their names. And they're having a conversation, except they're not really having a conversation. They're being interrogated. This isn't an equal relationship. This is them on the spot in custody. By what authority do you do this? How can you do this? After all, you're not wearing the fancy robes. You're not a part of the institution. How dare you do this? And what do they say? "This Jesus, whom you've crucified, whom God, Father, I'm assuming, raised. The Spirit who sent us here to proclaim him. The stone that you have rejected has become the cornerstone." And in that proclamation, they stir up some more trouble, don't they? This is the Trinitarian trajectory. It sends us out. It causes trouble in our lives. It challenges our assumptions. It calls us together. Because what's going on? It's not about the institution of that. Think of the movement that's happening. When Peter was out preaching and telling people about what God had done, this same speech, really, about how the people had rejected Jesus and how he was crucified and God raised them and the Spirit sent them there. The people asked, "What do we do? Repent. Be baptized." And they did, thousands of them. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of the bread and to prayers. It's about the community of faith that is the church. That is our foundation. The Trinitarian trajectory. It brings us together and it sends us out in a whole new way. And we were at Synod Assembly, and one of the stories that was told was about a church in Lawrence, Massachusetts. You know the pastor there? He's a great guy. Eric Warringer. Anyway, it's a typical story. The church was founded by German immigrants They came over because there were jobs in Lawrence and they worked in the factories. And the economy was booming and the church boomed along with it. And like many of our churches, pretty typical. The people of the church got married. They had children. They married and had children. They married and had children. And like many of our churches, times changed. The factories closed. The children that did well went off to school. Many of them didn't come back. And the other children didn't come back. And the other children didn't come back. And like many of our communities, this once thriving church, the people that could move out of town because the opportunities were there did that too. And like so many of our communities where our churches are, the neighborhood around the church changed. And there were new people there. New people that didn't have the same heritage. New people that didn't speak the same language. New people that they weren't even Lutherans. And the church, you know, plugged along, doing what it did. But then the Trinitarian trajectory stepped in once again. They started listening in a new way. They started looking around them in a new way. They started engaging in a new way. The pastor, Eric, who didn't speak Spanish, learned how to speak Spanish. And some of the people said, we should do that too, and they learned Spanish along with them. They learned about who these people were and where they came from. Many of them had come from places where, you know, they were kind of like on the run from something dangerous. Many of them, not all of them, but a lot of them, didn't have proper documentation. Some of them, many of them, I don't know how many, they were afraid, really, really afraid of what might happen to them now that ICE was out looking for them. They started paying more attention to the violence that was in their neighborhood, and when people gathered for prayer vigils when someone had died, they started going to those and praying alongside them. And when some people started organizing in the community because the drug problem had gotten so bad, they wanted to be in that conversation too. And then in some of the friendships that they had started to develop, they discovered that a lot of people back in their home country had gardened. You know, they grew vegetables in their backyards and such, much like a lot of you do. And since they were in an urban environment and kind of a decaying city, there weren't a lot of green spaces to do that, including the places where many people lived. So they started having some conversations and looking around their neighborhood, and they found a plot of land that was not really being used. And they cleaned it up, and they started to cultivate it a little bit, and they built some raised beds. And they invited people from the community at no charge to kind of take ownership of one of these beds and grow their vegetables. Now, did this result in, you know, huge memberships? No. Is it a perfect redeployment of what it means to be the church in the 21st century? Far from it. Was there some religious institutional pushback about doing any of this? Absolutely. Of course. But this is what God does. Father, Son, Holy Spirit troubles the waters, challenges our assumptions, helps us see in a new way and listen in a new way, reminds us of who we are. People who claim that Jesus is the Christ. And amazingly, in some of those relationships, it is almost as if they met the person at the gate and would be able to say, in the name of Jesus Christ, get up. It's a beautiful story, still in progress. I think about about us and all the things we are doing that are so wonderful, including the fact that we have air conditioning again this morning. And I look at the new walkway in the back, and it's really a lot nicer than I thought it was going to be. It's beautiful. And I look at the wood that's all framed up in the back where we'll have new restrooms, and the fellowship hall will be nice, and thinking about how this space will be. I think, man, this is great. This is really worth celebrating. But we've got to pay attention and make sure that it's not about just the bricks and mortar. That it's not just about the stuff we do in the walls. That it's about who we are and who God calls us to be. About getting stirred up when God shows up in our lives. About being reminded that when God's word comes to us, it challenges us often. To be reminded that as the body of Christ, we can challenge one another and struggle with each other sometimes, and that's also okay. To know that when Christ comes and enters our lives, this one whom we at times reject and have crucified, and yet God has raised, is the name by which we are saved. And the Spirit comes to send us out once again. So that we can look to each other when we are struggling. Or we can look to our neighbor who is struggling. So we can find those who are sitting at the gate, along with Peter and John and all the others, which we claim on this day at all days. We can say with full confidence, in the name of Jesus Christ, get up. So let's stand and sing.